Thank you so much, Emery and Kim. Isn't that wonderful to have young people leading us in worship here from Sunday to Sunday? We are blessed. In a moment, we're going to sing the song, All Creatures of Our God and King. And thinking about that, there are people who do worship nature. I mean, that is a option. Psalm 148 says, no, if we flip that around. All nature worships God. And that's what the song we're going to sing speaks of. And I just want to read a couple words from Psalm 148 that speaks about that very thing. All nature, all creation, joining to worship God. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him in the heights above. Praise Him, all His angels. Praise Him, all His heavenly hosts. Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all you shining stars. Praise Him, you highest heavens. And you waters above the skies, and the psalm keeps going like that. Let all creation join and praise our God. Would you stand with me for our greeting? And then we're going to sing together. We'll stay standing after that. We're going to confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. But first, God greets us tonight because God is our Father. We're brothers and sisters here this evening, and He greets us with these words, grace and mercy and peace be to you from God our Father, from our Lord Jesus Christ, and through the powerful presence of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen. Let's confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let's say them together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to sing a song in just a moment that will lead us into a time of prayer. And that time of prayer, I will explain. It'll be just a little bit different. Oh, we've done this before, but it's been a while. And so as we adopt a posture and attitude of prayer, let's sing this song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, together. After this time of prayer, there'll be an opportunity. We're going to have song requests, and they can come from the gray songbook, the Psalter at your seats. We'll probably do about three of those, so be thinking about that. But I want to invite you into a time of prayer, of guided prayer. And what that means is I'm just going to give us all some prompts. There'll be some music playing and just some prompts for us to pray individually and come to God, especially looking back on the week that just was. And so would you join me in prayer together? And as we begin, perhaps you just prepare yourself for prayer by focusing, even right now, on your breathing. And take a few deep breaths in, and then a few releasing breaths out. And even as you do that, notice how that change in breath brings a stillness and an awareness of God's presence. And so as you breathe, begin to pray and give thanks to God for this day that you've just lived, which is a gift from God. And would you express your gratitude to Him for this day? And then if you'd cast your mind back over the past week, do you recall any challenges that you experienced? Maybe it was a challenge to love an enemy or to trust in a very difficult situation. Maybe it was a challenge to hope in the face of some trial or suffering. Was it the Spirit's prompting to repent or to forgive? Just bring that to God. Again, as you scan over the week that was, is there a particular moment that God is drawing you to remember? And maybe it's just something that rises to the surface naturally. And allow yourself to Reflect on that moment, whatever comes to your mind. And as it does, do you notice any tensions or frustration? Any confusion or maybe some clarity? And whatever that is that comes to mind, would you just allow those moments to be witnessed by yourself and by God? And then where in this past day or this past week have you experienced some opening of your heart, perhaps to some challenge that has come from God's word or from his spirit? Where have you been prompted to step forward in some way, in service or in gratitude? Again, just notice what rises naturally in your mind. And then, as we draw our prayer to a close, reflecting on the fact that we have a week before us. We're standing at the beginning of these 7 days to come. And what is it that you would ask God for? What do you need to practice? What do you or I need to incorporate into our lives? And again, whatever rises to the surface, would you bring that to God and ask for his help and his grace? Lord, we thank you for moments of quiet, moments of prayer. Now, Lord, you know our hearts even better than we know them ourselves. Lord, would you enable your spirit to be at work in us? Lord, you have told us that prayer is powerful and effective. And so, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, would you lead us and guide us into this new week and all that you have for us? Lord, help us to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Lord, help us to have the mind of Christ. We thank you again for this day and all that it has given us. We thank you for this time of worship and your presence with us. And these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. To continue, I think of songs oftentimes are really not much different than prayer. So I said we have an opportunity to offer a couple of, or probably three or so songs. So if you have a song that you'd like to sing out of this book, just raise your hand or shout out the number. Yeah, Linda, and if you could pick a couple verses, that'd be great. And you know I don't always hear so well, so you may have to shout it out. 500. 500. Is that a mighty fortress?
No.
500. One in five. Oh, yeah, how firm a foundation. Perfect. We are in the middle of a firm foundation class, an investigating profession of faith class, and this is where that title comes from. One in five, number 500, how firm a foundation.
Thank you.
Harold.
548.
One and three. Yep, number 548. And we're going to sing verses 1 and 3 of When We Walk with the Lord. Thank you, Harold. Yeah, Sylvia. 461, all four. You're going to break the rules, aren't you, Sylvia? That's good. Have to sing all four of those. And why don't we stand while we're singing? Number 461, right? Beautiful Savior.
Thank you.
Thank you for those songs, beautiful hymns of faith. Tonight we're going to turn to Psalm 38. So I invite you to find that passage in your Bible. And if you're here this morning, I mentioned that this is kind of a two-part little mini-series where this morning we thought about Psalm 51, which is a psalm of David as well, a familiar psalm. And it's more about a guilty past. And David confesses his sin over all the things that he had done. And it wasn't just that big sin. He's talking about all his transgressions, right? That's important to remember. But then tonight, we're shifting it a bit and asking, but what about our, if we could say, our innocent past? Like, how do we get, maybe not necessarily past it, but how do we get through it? How do we keep moving forward when we have things in our past that were done to us, or experiences we had, or suffering, or trials that we endured? How do we move through that? It's a little bit different. And this psalm is like the psalm this morning, Psalm 51, a penitential psalm. You'll see that some of it sounds like Psalm 51. David is confessing his sins, but then there's also, and we'll come back to this word, there's lament in this psalm too. Why has this happened, O God? Why have these people done these things to me? Why am I experiencing this or that? So you'll find both in this psalm, and I'll read it for us tonight. O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your wrath. For your arrows have pierced me, and your hand has come down upon me. Because of your wrath, there is no health in my body. My bones have no soundness because of my sin. My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear. My wounds fester and are loathsome because of my sinful folly. I am bowed down and brought very low. All day long I go about mourning. My back is filled with searing pain. There is no health in my body. I am feeble and utterly crushed. I groan in anguish of heart. All my longings lie open before you, O Lord. My sighing is not hidden from you. My heart pounds. My strength fails me. Even the light has gone from my eyes. My friends and companions avoid me because of my wounds. My neighbors stay far away. Those who seek my life set their traps. Those who would harm me talk of my ruin. All day long they plot deception. I'm like a deaf man who cannot hear, like a mute who cannot open his mouth. I have become like a man who does not hear, whose mouth can offer no reply. I wait for you, O Lord. You will answer, O Lord my God. For I said, do not let them gloat or exalt themselves over me when my foot slips. For I am about to fall, and my pain is ever with me. I confess my iniquity. I am troubled by my sin. Many are those who are my vigorous enemies. Those who hate me without reason are numerous. Those who repay my good with evil slander me when I seek what is good. O Lord, do not forsake me. Be not far from me, O my God. Come quickly to help me, O Lord, my Savior. God's word for us tonight. And we're going to think about that together. And to do that, I want to read something that I came across this week. It's a story. I'll just read it. This is from the news account, and it happened a bit ago, but some of it is in quotes. So while hunting deer in the Tehama Wildlife Area near Red Bluff in Northern California, a guy named Jay Rathman climbed to a ledge on the slope of a rocky gorge. And as he raised his head to look over this ledge, he sensed movement to the right of his face. He turned, and he is face to face with a rattlesnake. This coiled rattler, he said, struck with lightning speed, just missing his right ear. The four-foot snake's fangs from the strike got stuck in Jay Rathman's turtleneck collar of his sweater. And while he's trying to pull the snake loose, the rest of the snake starts to wrap around his neck. He grabbed it from behind the head, and with his left hand, he could feel the warm venom from the snake running down the skin of his neck underneath his sweater. And the rattles were just making this furious racket. If the person next to you is getting a little lightheaded, you know, we can call an usher here. Just imagining this, think, oh, wow. So it gets worse. He's on this ledge, and all of this is happening. Snake coiled around his neck, venom running down his neck, and he then falls backward, slid head first, backward down the steep slope through brush and rocks, his rifle and binoculars bouncing beside him, with the snake stuck in his sweater and wrapped around his neck the entire time. Then this is his quote, as luck would have it, he said, describing this to the fish and game warden. He said, I ended up wedged between some rocks with my feet caught uphill from my head. I could barely move. He says, I got my right hand on my rifle, and I used it to disengage the fangs from the sweater, but the snake had enough leverage to strike again. Quote, he made about 8 attempts and managed to hit me with his nose just below my eye about 4 times. I kept my face turned so he couldn't get a good angle with his fangs, but it was very close. He says, this chap and I were eyeball to eyeball, and I found out that snakes don't blink. He had fangs like darning needles. He said, I had to literally choke him to death. It was the only way out. I was afraid with all the blood rushing to my head that I might pass out. But then this is what struck me, other than just this amazing story. But he said this, when I tried to toss the dead snake aside, you know, he'd grasped it behind the head to kill it. So when I tried to toss this dead snake aside, I couldn't let go. I couldn't pry my fingers off from its neck. Now, I read that story, and I thought, seriously? What kind of guy just makes it through something like that? But then it struck me as well that this individual going through this incredibly traumatic, life-threatening experience was experiencing the trauma. You know, can I let go of this thing that has just almost taken my life? And how do I do that? Now, that's just a physical response, right? But I thought that's very perceptive in the way we think about the things that have happened to us, the traumas, the suffering, the hurt, the abuse that comes into our lives in different ways. And it can be so intense that we have a hard time letting it go. We may really struggle with that. Can we let those things go? Should we let them go? And if we think, I've got to let this thing go, how do I even do that? What does that look like? Well, we're going to think about that here tonight. And using these words from Psalm 38, also, by the way, connected to this, you notice in a couple weeks we're going to have a series we're going to go through on Sunday nights, the book of Job, and there's some connection to that as well. This message, as I said this morning, connects with some of the things we've been talking about on Sunday mornings, about God's design for our lives and our relationships and how we view ourselves, and this really flows out of that discussion. But here, this individual in that story, Jay Rathman, I mean, he's just innocent. He's just out there doing his thing, and this thing happens. And we might think about our lives or people we know, and something similar happens. How about David's life? This morning, we looked at David, and we said, well, there are a number of things that David did where he was, if you remember a couple weeks, we talked about characters in the story. David was the villain, clearly the villain. And then there are other experiences in David's life where he is clearly the victim. Things happen to him. He's betrayed by Ahithophel. He's betrayed by his son Absalom. Saul, King Saul, tries to kill him. And there's that account back, I can't remember what book that's in, well, in Samuel, 1st or 2nd Samuel, where that guy named Shimei is just lobbing curses at David. And David kind of brushes it off. But in this psalm, we also hear that David is going through some illness of some sort. Terrible illness. And while he is sick, then there are these enemies who are plotting to trap him and to take him out. There are people who are speaking falsehoods about him, trying to entrap him in a variety of different ways, and he's talking about all this stuff that's happening to him. Now, again, he's not some innocent character completely. No one is. But in some of those experiences, well, he could rightly say, I'm being attacked, or I'm experiencing this illness. Why, God? And then we think about our experiences today, which may not exactly parallel David's. Look up the statistics, though, on abuse. Physical, emotional, sexual, verbal abuse of children, teenagers, adults, senior citizens. The statistics are troubling. People who did not ask for any of that, did nothing to bring that on, and yet they were victims of that. I mean, think of the people who have some disease, some awful thing that strikes them physically. And then they have the fallout of that, trying to make sense of why this happened. Think of children who are bullied at school. Think of domestic abuse situations where people are literally, beating each other. Think of all of the crimes that happen. Maybe you've been a victim of crime, and you know exactly how awful that feels to be victimized by a criminal. It's a horrible thing. And we could go on and on. Betrayal, abuse, words that were said to you or to me that just are lodged in your mind like a verbal bullet, and they don't go away. These things that are from your past that you might say, I don't know if I can get past that. I don't know if I can get past that. And sometimes you'll see it. Sometimes you can almost physically see it. People who've had any one of those things that I've mentioned or something else happen to them, and it's like it's left them emotionally damaged. Right? They find that they're, well, they find maybe it's very difficult to receive love or to demonstrate love. They find that there's a simmering anger just beneath the surface, and they're just like almost ready to go off on anybody who might say just the wrong thing. They go through their life like a victim. They're hurt. Sometimes you can see it, sometimes you can't, but it has left a mark. Oftentimes, someone in that situation will just isolate themselves. They say, I don't want to be near anyone else. Leave me alone. Maybe they go numb in some way. Maybe they numb themselves in some way. And those are just the normal things that happen in our lives. And I'm sure statistically, some of us know exactly what that's like. And compounding all of those symptoms or characteristics might be the person who just says, because of that thing that happened, I have lost my hope for the future. There's a loss of joy in the presence, in the present moment. It's a real thing. This is not unusual. This is not just some random person here and there. This is many people who feel this way. And some people have that experience, that bad thing that happened, and that's exactly where they end up, maybe for the rest of their lives. The remarkable thing is, though, for me, is that I've seen, while that can happen, it doesn't always happen that way. So that you might have someone else who's endured a very similar experience, and yet they don't become bitter somehow. And maybe those of us around them might say, I don't know how you haven't, but you haven't become bitter. You somehow found a way through it. know, you'll never forget it. But somehow, if we can even say it this way, instead of becoming bitter, you've somehow become, can we say it better? You'd never wish for that to happen. You'd do anything to undo it. And yet something has occurred in your life to say, I'm going to be okay. And I know God's got this. Now, I want to think through that a little bit more with, and I hope you hear that, just deep humility, knowing that even the things that I've mentioned can be touching on very painful things. That in a few moments together on a Sunday night, there is no way that we can cover all of those things, in no way. And as I mentioned this morning, the danger would be that for me to say a few things, even from God's word, might sound very trite and way too simple based on what you've been through. And I understand that. Believe me, I do. So with that in mind, though, we do turn to God's word. And as we do, we find that there may be, I'll use the word steps like we did this morning, but that too is problematic. Perhaps some perspectives would be a better word to say, well, how do we move through this, whatever this is for you or for me? And I'll share some of my story too, just to keep it honest. But to begin, I want to focus here where we ended this morning. Because this morning, remember I mentioned that Martin Luther the Reformer, was struggling with guilt. And his spiritual advisor, a spiritual director, said, Martin, you need to stop looking so much at your sin and you need to look at Jesus. That's where we ended this morning, and that's where I would begin tonight, with our guilty past and also with our innocent past, that we begin and end by looking to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Just think about it. You look at Jesus' life, I mean, he knew what it was like to be rejected, to be abused, to have threats hurled at him, to have his life threatened earlier on. He was spit at. He was beaten. He was mocked. He goes to a cross and dies this horrible death. You think of all that he endured, and not even to mention giving up the glory of heaven to come and be in the middle of all of this sin and muck and mire of humanity. But it's when he goes to the cross, right? You might remember. I mean, before that, Judas has betrayed him, one of his inner circle. But he goes to the cross and everybody else bails. Maybe you say, I've been there. You say, a close friend, someone I thought I could count on. And when it really got tough, they were gone. Well, that happens to Jesus. Luke tells us in chapter 23 that all his friends and followers stood at a distance watching what happened to him. And one Bible teacher says that that is probably referencing Psalm 38 that we read, especially verse 8, which says, or verse 11, I'm in the wrong psalm here. Here we go. Verse 8, which says, I am feeble and utterly crushed. I groan in anguish of heart. Right? Jesus knew that experience on the cross. And then verse 11, my friends and companions avoid me. Because of my wounds, my neighbors stay away. And that's what happens to Jesus. And yet it's Jesus who would say in Matthew 11, the beautiful passage where he says, but come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened. Yeah, that burden. And I will give you rest. So, again, steps. I don't know that I like that word, but a few perspectives on what do we do? Again, thinking about David's experience, Jesus' experience, what do we do with those things that have happened to us that weren't our fault, but they did happen to us? And the first thing is this, very simply, just maybe sounds a little too simple, simpler than it really is, but to acknowledge exactly what happened. And oftentimes people will go through life and they really have not even come to terms with exactly what has happened. David gets very explicit in the psalm, doesn't he? He says, this happened, this illness and these threats and the people, the things they said and what they were doing to me, those hurts, and he acknowledges them. To acknowledge to yourself, especially what has happened. Well, what if I don't? Well, what if you don't? And what if you bury those things? What if you bury that hurt and just don't deal with it? I would suggest that you bury those things very much alive, and they will come back. They will come out in some way. To acknowledge what happens is very important. What happened? How did it happen? And to acknowledge that hurt to God. I just put a couple of verses up there. There are many more that could be listed. Among the one that I just mentioned, Matthew chapter 11, where Jesus says, come to me. But those two verses on the screen, just a couple of the examples where God says, come to me. Bring those hurts to me. So I've acknowledged it in my own mind. I've said, this thing hurt me terribly. I'm not going to avoid it. I'm not going to try to say, oh, it's no big deal. I'm not going to try to bury it. I'm going to bring it out into the light, and then I'm going to acknowledge it to God. Here is the hurt that I am experiencing, God. Because if I keep those secrets dark, in the dark, someone said, we're only as neurotic as our darkest secrets. The things we keep in the dark, oh, that's dangerous. We bring it to the light, our own mind, and especially to God, then healing begins. It's not going to begin unless those things happen. There's a word for this, and we find it right in the Bible, and it's the word lament. And that's what David is doing in part in this psalm, but you can go to many other psalms, Psalm 21, Psalm 22, Psalm 6, there's a number. Just Google it. You'll find psalms of lament, right? Where a lament, I'm expressing my tears, my sorrow to God over what has happened. And it might be my own sin, but it might be something that was innocent, something that has happened to me. And what is a lament? It's where I come to God with this hurt, this guilt, whatever it is, this thing that I can't understand, especially in the case of an innocent past, that God, I can't make sense of this, and yet I know you are good and you are gracious and you are in control. I have this hurt and I have this faith and I don't know exactly how those fit together. I just don't. But I'm taking it to you and I am bringing this lament. And if you've been there, you would say, yes, as a believer, you say, I've done that, right? And I brought those things to God, and even though I don't understand, even though my faith is through a mirror dimly, yet on the other side of that, I recognize in some way my faith is strengthened. And even with all of the stuff that's happened to me, or all of the questions I have, when they get kind of boiled away, I'm still left with this knowledge, this bedrock truth that there is a God, and he loves me, and he loves you, and he is in control in ways that I cannot fully understand. But I have not stopped bringing that to him. To do that is to lament. Of course, many of you know that almost 3 years ago, we lost our son, Colby. And folks have asked me recently about that, and I'm always thankful for that. But I haven't talked about that much, very intentionally, in our times like this, very intentionally. But, you know, I had a couple of people ask me, so where are you at with that? Where does your grief live these days? And I thought, well, lament, that's where it often is. It's in lament. I think I referenced this book maybe a couple years ago when I was talking with you about our loss. And Nicholas Walterstorff, he was a professor at Calvin College. He's retired now, but he's a philosopher. And he lost his 25-year-old son in a mountaineering accident. And he writes about that in this book, A Lament for a Son, which I had read back in college, or shortly after that. At the time when I read it then, I thought, wow, this guy's a little raw. Can you really say that? Is that good? I read it again a couple months after Colby died, and I said, well, this is exactly right. He's expressing it exactly. And some of you, as I read just a bit of this, you'll say, yeah, that's exactly right. Just a paragraph. He says, again, this is lament, not a biblical lament of the Psalms, but a lament of this father. He says, I have no explanation. I can do nothing else than endure in the face of the deepest and most painful of mysteries. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He says, I believe in that. I also believe that my son's life was cut off in its prime, and I cannot fit those pieces together. I am at a loss. I have read the theodicies produced to justify the ways of God to man. I find them unconvincing. To the most agonized question I have ever asked, I do not know the answer. I do not know why God would watch him fall. I do not know why God would watch me wounded. I cannot even guess. And again, reading that again, I thought, that's just honest. That's truth. And as I read that, and I'm reading it through my experience, you have your experience. Some of you have deep hurts. Put your situation into that lament. And it might be some other loss. It may be some abuse, some other horrific thing. And you'll come to the same place, perhaps. I have these two things. And I bring them up to God, and I don't know how to reconcile it. And that is lament. And that's important to do. Right? I can't keep it buried. That's not good. I can acknowledge the hurt, and then I can acknowledge it to myself, and I can acknowledge it to God. And if I didn't do those things, as people told me, good, wise advice, when our experience of grief began, said, don't try to cut it, face it, walk through it. And again, many of you know that. Maybe you've tried hiding it or doing the shortcut thing, and you say, that's not working. So we bring it to God. And then we share the hurt with someone you trust. Galatians 6:2 says, share each other's burdens, and in this way, obey the law of Christ. What does it say in Scripture? Comfort one another, pray for one another, encourage one another. I acknowledge this hurt you do to yourself and to God, and then I find somebody that I can trust, and I need to bring it to them. Now, some people have said, now, you know, and again, I'm just keeping it real tonight. People have said, you know, I don't hear you say a lot about the loss of Colby. Here in times like this, I said, no, you're right. That's not because I'm not thinking about it nonstop. My laments are daily. And I do also talk that out with other people, trusted people, so that it doesn't come out sideways here, because it could if I didn't do that. So to share with someone what that is like and what you're going through, and to process that with somebody. We have our Pine Rest partnership, or maybe it's a pastor, maybe it's an elder, maybe it's a friend, maybe it's somebody you know that you can just be honest with. And it's going to be hard. And here's why it's going to be hard. Because the devil will say, I would like to have you just isolated and holding on to all that hurt. Oh, because if you do that and you don't deal with it and process it, well, you're a sitting duck. The devil loves for us to go numb, to go isolated. Absolutely. And I'm so thankful that the Psalms show us a different model. No, bring this out to God. Write it down in a song to be sung among God's people. And there's something about doing that, bringing it out into the light, that it doesn't take away the hurt. It doesn't take it away, but it helps us walk through it. For some of us, we might say, in some situations, I have gotten past it. With some things, maybe that's not the right language. But we share the hurt with somebody. Taking every thought captive. As you're doing these things, again, David, as he writes in the Psalms and in these laments, he's often saying, God, shape my thoughts. Help me to think about this correctly. And he's reminding himself of the things he knows about God. God, I know you are good, and I know your plans are right. He's saying those things even as he's working through this hurt. So to take every thought captive, the Apostle Paul's words, I think it's so important. Why? Because most people say the past is always present. The hurt that you've gone through, right? You'll be going along. If it was a deep hurt, you'll be going along and there's just something will hit. And that past thing, it may have been 30, 40, 50 years ago, and it is as present as your hands in front of your face are right now. It's right there. The past is always present with those traumatic things. And that becomes a spiritual battle then, doesn't it? Spiritual warfare. As I said, the devil would love for you to just collapse, to fade, to go numb, isolate. Scripture says, no, do just the opposite. To take every thought captive. So those thoughts come into your mind to take this hurt that you've experienced, whatever it is, and maybe to lash out in revenge or to go bitter, or whatever it is, whatever you might be more prone to do. The Apostle Paul would say, no, but take that thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. And I imagine it like this. You've been through the airport and that you go through the TSA, right? And you get up to the thing, the metal detector, and you got to empty your pockets, you got to take your shoes off, take your belt off, all that stuff goes through. Maybe we need something like that in our mind. That thought comes in, we say, oh, wait a minute, thought. you need to take out your keys, take out this stuff. I'm not just letting you barge in with all this stuff. You're going to come clean. You are not going to own me. You're not going to hijack. You are not going to be some terrorist that comes in and takes over my thoughts. Take every thought captive. Why? Because it's a battle. As we filter those things, like David does in the Psalm, he says, no, God, I know this to be true. I can't understand all of the things that have happened, but I know this to be true. And I'm going to remind myself of that. I'm going to preach the gospel to myself again and again. You see, it's a process. This is a process, isn't it? It's a process that, if we are honest and go through it, can lead us to life. Absolutely. But for some of you, when you think of the past and the hurt that you've gone through, the next word I'm going to say will make you think, really? Here's the word, forgiveness. And so you want to say, ah. Knew you were going to say that. We're not going to go into forgiveness and all that it is. There are many things that it isn't. Certainly doesn't mean letting go of or letting someone off the hook or letting justice fall by the wayside. None of those things. It does mean letting go of what may be a very righteous anger, letting go of the desire to seek vengeance, letting go of bitterness. It may be that you're doing that as you're calling up the police and saying, you need to come and arrest this person and put them in jail. All the while, you are saying, I am not going to hold on to this anger because I know it will destroy me. But that, too, is a process, isn't it? It's a process. Let me go back, as we end, to Nicholas Walterstorff. Remember his lament for a son. He went through a prolonged season of grief, which, of course, never goes away. But in writing about that, he says, yes, I questioned God's goodness. I tried to make sense of the mystery of evil. The incomprehensibility of suffering just kept coming at him again and again. But he says, but then the day finally dawned. Walterstorff was led to see, quote, to believe in Christ rising from the grave is to accept it as a sign of our own rising from our graves. And then he goes on, he says, slowly I began to see that there is something more as well. And I have some of it on there. I'm going to read it. It says, to believe in Christ rising and death's dying is also to live with the power and the challenge to rise up now from all our dark graves of suffering love. And this part especially. If sympathy for the world's wounds is not enlarged by our anguish, if love for those around us is not expanded, if gratitude for what is good does not flame up, if insight is not deepened, if commitment to what is important is not strengthened, if aching for a new day is not intensified, if hope is weakened and faith diminished, if from the experience of death comes nothing good, then death has won. Then death be proud. So I shall struggle to live the reality of Christ rising and death's dying. And he says, in my living, my son's dying will not be the last word. And I would echo that last sentence, but you may rephrase it. And you might say, in my living, my, what hurt might it be? That will not have the last word. This morning, you saw that picture of the broken pottery, kintsugi, that Japanese art where pottery is broken and then put back together using gold. Where something broken becomes something beautiful. That's what Walterstorff is getting at here, right? He's saying, even in those broken places, because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because death has been defeated, he can take even those hurts, even those. And by his grace, some beauty comes shining out. And one day we know that all of those things will be rolled back and undone. And we long for that day. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, tonight we, with the psalmist, bring our hurts and our sorrows and our grief before you. Lord, you know those things. Lord, you know the words, the actions, the abuse, the trauma, the pain, the loss. You know that. Oh, Lord, we pray that in some way we might bring that to light, that we might seek healing, that we, Lord, might find in you grace that enables us to continue. Maybe it's just step by step, moment by moment. But Lord, we need you, and we need your grace, and we need your mercy, and we need the hope that only you provide. So Lord, help us. Have mercy on us. We pray this in your name. Amen. Let's stand for a benediction and a final song. Dear friends, today we've heard the good news of the gospel, and we're now sent to go out and to bring that good news into our week, wherever we will be. And so go with our Lord's blessing as you do that. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn towards you right now and give you his peace. And all God's people said, amen.